frankly taking notes. I don't know if I'm going to say anything that's really worth taking notes. So if you want, I'm just putting this out there. If you want to come sit down here, or you want to pull your chair over, you know, I'm an old hippie, right? So I was on dead tour, and it's all right. You can come and sit down if you want. No big whoop, by the way. I'll give you a moment to do that. My ulterior motive for asking you to do that is I didn't bring anything to put on the projector, but I have lots of little odds and ends here. So you'll get a better view if you come step front.
All the girls can.
That's the way I like it. Special shout out to the ladies right back there.
Although, I almost said I didn't make any slides, but I did make two slides here because, you know,
and Raul.
Dave, we really like your presentations, but damn it, would you give us a bulleted list? So, as someone who's put on a lot of these conferences and camps, I want to echo what John said about big ups to the organizers. This is a totally fancy place. I feel a little intimidated kind of coming in here, like the security's going to be shaking me down in a minute. But there's no problems out back when we had our safety meeting, so if anyone was wondering, it's apparently what they say about Whistler is true. So today we learned a lot about how to deliver content. What I'm going to talk about is, I don't know, figuring out what that content is. And I also want to, in doing so, I want to kind of, sometimes we think about blogging as both the delivery method and the content. I'm making a blog post, I'm blogging. How do we arrange these words? But really, blogging and blogs is a delivery method, because WordPress isn't just a blog, as we've learned from the ambassador from Norway. that this is just another tool in a long lineage of methods for publishing expression. And I'm going to start my story on what was in a really eventful day for me. I was living on the island of Guam. You ever seen Guam? You know anything about it? Nobody does. So I brought a picture. There's a picture, which serves no purpose. Except it's a really cool map, though, I think. But this is a little island that's 30 miles by 11 miles. And I worked at a private beach club, which if I would have been 19 and single, I might have stayed at my entire life. But you can see it was a really weird job. Here I am. You can pick me out, because I'm the guy that's white that's not wearing a t-shirt. And I worked at this beach job. And every day I'd go there, and all the Japanese tourists would come to this island, and I'd help them have a really good time. All right, we're going to go horseback riding, then we're going to play volleyball on the beach. Awesome. But it was all in Japanese. Like, minasan, konnichiwa. And then a significant event happened and that really changed things a lot for me. And that was Jerry Garcia dying. I know you're all shedding a single tear. For those of you under 30, Jerry Garcia played in a rock and roll band. The Grateful Dead were popular in the 60s. And he was famous enough that they made an ice cream about him. And I quit my job that day because I wanted to, I figured I'd go to San Francisco for like the funeral, because I was a big deadhead, everyone would be partying and celebrating. But I didn't make it because it's really expensive to get off the islands. That's one thing, if you haven't been to the islands, you should know. It's easy to get there, but really hard to get off the islands. So I went to an impromptu candlelight vigil, and I have proof of that because here is the Pacific Daily News from Guam. And it says in here, let's see, blah, 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 bunch of crap, where's the good part? David Olson, 25, has traveled through Japan, Europe, Mexico, and all over the United States. And each stop, there have been Grateful Dead fans there to greet him. Hallelujah! There's a quote from me. There is no one else that brings people together like that, said Olson, who took the day off from work. Day off. Now, when he heard the news of Garcia's death, he had a message for the people who ridicule reactions to Garcia's death. I think the people are jealous, he said. He beat me. He managed to spell my last name twice in the same article, too, by the way. They see people living their dreams and being free. They just want to be free themselves. It's moving, isn't it? So I was talking to these guys from the newspaper, and I was saying, well, you know, I really want to go out to the funeral, and it's going to be this big celebration, but I don't know what's going on. And And they knew all the answers to what was going on. And I said, wow, how do you know all this? And they said, we work for the newspaper. We have the internet. The internet? Tell me of this internet thing you speak of. What is this? And they said something about computers and phone lines, and explained that I didn't really get it. And then I was like, so I can put words and pictures up on this thing, and then people can go with their computers, and they can look at it anytime, anywhere, for free or cheap? Yep. And I was like, wow, I've got to get some of this. Because as you're going to learn over the next little bit of time, is I had a little interest in all this personal publishing stuff. This map's just in here, I don't know why. It's a whole map of Oceania, so if anyone has any questions about Micronesian geography afterwards. Which brings me to the first slide. Actually, I'm going to have to put this down for a second. Amuse yourself. Because, like they said, you got to have, usually a presentation has to have at least one bullet list and at least one buzzword. So I thought I'd get these both out of the way with my one of my two slides here. The other one I put a chart on, but that's just a little preview. And there in Guam, when I learned about, like that, I'll read these one by one. Don't worry, you don't have to strain your eyes in the back. And learn about the internet, I realized that this was the missing piece of the whole personal publishing, self-publishing tensions or conundrums. I've called them here holistic. That's kind of a half buzzword point. Publishing paradigms. Oh, there's the buzzword. There's your buzzword. Or tensions for the academics there. Tensions or syndromes, perhaps. So the first puzzle is distribution. That's the first one of the puzzles that had to be figured out for. And when I talk about publishing and these conundrums, this is artists making stuff, getting it over here to someone who's interested enough to read this. There's a bunch of little steps and things that have to happen along the way. The next one is it has to take some form. There has to be some artifact or some thing that people hold or look at and can consume the piece of personal publishing in. Then there's the regulatory stuff, which I'm going to get into quite a bit here in just a little bit. And this is talking about both terms of intellectual property law and censorship and a few other things like that. And then there needs to be quality discourse. There needs to be a certain high level of writing. It has to be something that says something important and says it in an artistic way. Maybe artistic's not the best word there, it's a little bit subjective, but it has to put it in a clear and proper manner. And then, finally, this last ingredient is there needs to be something to express, which seems like, well, duh. But honestly, it's sometimes it's the last one to come into the mix. There you go. See, I was smart enough to take my notebook, turn it sideways so it can stand up there. Look at that. Yeah, look at that. PowerPoint, schmowerpoint, eh? Look at that. So, let's unpack, as conference facilitators like to say, let's unpack those topics. I started thinking first about writing and personal expression and self-expression were some of the earliest forms that we have. And, I went to college and stuff, right? You know, I'd studied some art stuff. I don't have a black turtleneck or anything, right? But, like, I read the Greeks, and here we have some of the earliest pieces of literature that exists. And really, if you read this stuff, here's the Oresteia by Aeschylus, one of the oldest tomes. This in the Odyssey, or kind of like the vintage things. You ever tried to read the Odyssey? Figure, you know, where they go from cavemen, we think of grunts and groans, but somehow the earliest written things that we have available to us are some of the most dense, intense works that have ever been produced ever, and they're some of the earliest things. And indeed, our entire legal system and our whole, dare I say, moral structure of modern society, what's right and what's wrong, really hasn't changed too much from the Greeks. And because I hauled all these books, if any of you follow me along on Twitter, through, I think they're up to 8 different buses, my suitcase of books have been on. I figure since I hauled them, I get to read a little bit from each one, right? It's all right with everyone? All right, so here's Agamemnon, the king. Do you remember that Brad Pitt movie that was all that completely change it? So if you've seen that, please forget all about it. Here is King Agamemnon returning from battle. For that we must thank the gods with a sacrifice. Our sons will long remember. for their mad outrage of a queen. We raped their city. We were right. This is thousands of years ago. I'm so angry. The beasts of Argos, foals of the wild mare, thousands masked in armor rose on the night the Pleiades went down and crashing through their walls. Our bloody lion lapped its fill, gorging on the blood of kings. Our thanks to the gods, long drawn out, but it is just the prelude.
Wow.
Well, they certainly had a flair for the dramatic, those ancient Greeks. And they wrote all these works that explain what we really see as the definitions and the underpinnings of our modern court system. This story goes on, and kings die, and it's all this Shakespearean-like drama that we see repeated throughout history in other cultures, including from the Chinese. Now, right around the same time, the Chinese were starting some written works. And but this work here I brought by, this is The Art of Writing by Li Ju. And here we are in 200 AD. And the Greeks had figured out all this moral underpinnings and all these grand things, what's right and what's wrong. Is it all right to kill people for revenge? Is revenge proper? Is that allowed? They've killed one of your families, an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, or should you forgive people? Meanwhile, the Chinese were saying, how can we make the writing really pretty? Here's, there's like 69, 70 some odd little stanzas about these different parts of writing. Hold on, I'm gonna have a sip of water so I can do this one proper. Because, you know, if you're going to take the time to write about all this killing of the kings and queens and lapping on the blood of kings like a gorged lion, you should have some structure, some technique, like revision. A sentence may contradict what comes before, trespass on what follows. Sometimes the idea is good, but words fail, and fine words may make no sense. In such cases, it is wise to set the two apart, since they harm each other when put together. It is delicate to judge which idea or words work better. A difference finer than wheat ears hairs. Weigh each word on a scale. Use a measuring cord to make your cuts. Now, anyone who's a designer, the designer's mantra is all about take out everything that doesn't absolutely need to be there. That's exactly what they're saying there. That's 200 AD. Have we really moved on too much from that? Has the editorial process changed dramatically? Not all that much. So then, ooh, this is the part where I use my electronic device. I'm going to move forward to the next big technological innovation in publishing. I'm talking about the Gutenberg Press. So, from the time of these books, things written down on various rags, animal skins, homemade papers, and whatnot, things progressed. Where books were hand copied, right? You had to sit down, you'd assemble, and people made it their life's work. Let's learn about these monks. From Richard de Bury, the Bishop of Durham, in 1345, he talked about the joy that these monks felt. Shall I? The venerable devotion of the religious orders is wont to be solicitous in the care of books and to delight in their society, as if they were the only riches. For some used to write them with their own hands between the hours of prayer, engaged in the making of books such intervals as they could secure, and at times appointed for the recreation of the body, by whose labors they are resplendent today in the monasteries, these sacred treasuries full of cherubic letters. Oh, such tender sentiments. So these monks were transcribing these books. Who were they transcribing for? Other monks. They're the only ones that could read, right? So it's like it didn't do anyone any good. So these monks, they had like their little private club where they would spend months, years writing one book. But of course, they were really transcribing one book over and over again. Guess which one? Anyone? Bible. And of course, everyone knows that, you know, I could do that a little bit better. Who wrote this draft of this? I'm copying my own copy. I'm gonna, look at that, there's a little stylistic flourish there. Change a little meaning here. And there's a lot of emphasis put on the physical artifact of the book. The words were complementary to the pictures, as we that quote with the cherubic pages. The pages were really decorated. And then the Gutenberg Press came. And of course, as you might expect, there was some resistance. There are some people who said, oh, this new technology, you can't just let anyone publish anything. What would happen? Good Lord. And then there was a revulsion by the clergy in the church saying, you know, who would ever, what literate, decent person would ever even put their hands on a printed book? What is the value of these printed books? We have handwritten books made with love. Why would anyone write, you know? It was an embarrassment to have a printed book. They were for the common people. Of course, there wasn't too many people that could read, but once you start making books, people go, hey, I have access to books. I should learn how to read, right? Why not? You have access to the information. So there was began a bit of tension between the polite society, the proper society, the religious society, and people who wanted to just print anything that they wanted. Yeah, you could almost call it a revolution. And then the next revolution came, which was the Industrial Revolution. And what happened is all these old Gutenberg presses, which didn't really change for the first 150, 200 years, these old wooden presses, they were all decommissioned because there's new awesome iron steam presses. We can have newspapers now. Oh, thank God for newspapers, eh? Came around this time. And what happened is all these old Gutenberg presses, they were claimed by the radicals, the hippies of their day. And so begat the underground press. And it was only a few short years before the underground press, especially in England at this time, began to have bigger circulation than the mainstream press. So the government stepped in and said, oh, you know, you're gonna have to register those presses. So that's why they loved the wooden presses, because you could just take them apart, unassemble them and take them and move them to another clandestine location and print out your things. And this led us into the American Revolution. Where this was a big hang-up with these, sometimes I have a hard time with early American history because there was all these, like, the framers and the Thomas Paines and all that, but then you think of all the Puritans, and I got some issues with the Puritans, right? Just Puritanism in general, but I'm going to just ignore them and go right to Thomas Paine and the people like them. And they started printing broadsides, and these basically manifestos. You know, when you think of manifesto, we think now of the Unabomber. I almost said Unabomber, but that's another guy. manifestos taking on this, like, you know, underground kind of meaning. But think about the Declaration of Independence, manifesto, and all these early documents. But they were able to disseminate that information because they had these clandestine, unregistered, illegal presses. And they made tremendous sacrifices to keep the word out and keep spreading the word. And so when they finally sat down and wrote the Constitution, they said, damn it, freedom of speech, freedom of all that press stuff, but they didn't really know what the press was. What is the press? Who is the press? Who? You know, I know there's an agency, and I know there's people who have, like, press cards and credentials. I know there's the Associated Press and the UPI, and there's people, and they have this whole little club, and they do this thing, and... But did the constitutional framers see it that way? And I know we're here in Canada and all that, right? But it just ties in better to the whole story arc if we just hum along with the American thing. Because we know the Canadian one, it wasn't in dramatic moments. It was like a long, drawn-out process of careful deliberation and cautious optimism, and eventually we reached a good compromise. So the constitutional framers said, oh, we got to have freedom of expression, freedom of press, and all this stuff, right? But then when it actually came down to allowing that, hold on. That there's indecent. We didn't say indecent expression was allowed. And in this book right here, this is played a huge role in opening up what we in modern liberal Western civilizations are allowed to read. Oh, let me get that. That's old. That's older than some of the kids in here, I think, that article there. And the U.S. took on a really awkward stance about copyright in the early days of the federation, country, whatever, right? For the first 100 years and change, the U.S. Deliberately did not respect foreign copyrights. Unless a physical artifact was printed and bound in America, it was considered basically public domain, piratable materials. That is the end of the inquiry, and the forfeiture must follow. Here's the best part. But in Ulysses, in spite of its unusual frankness, I do not detect anywhere the leer of a sensualist. That's a good word, eh? Sensualist? Mm-hmm. I hold, therefore, that it is not pornographic. Wow. And with that, This book opened up the floodgates to both importing of this book. By then, James Joyce was almost a ruined man and quite downtrodden and died shortly thereafter, blah, 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 happens to the best of them. But this stands up as a court case. It says literary works have merit. Now, this also meant that by importing it, by it being legally admissible, it could be produced in the United States, which meant it could be copyrighted within the United States. But there was this whole other gray market of all these other books and all these other copies. So this book really started a lot of the conundrum about the modern intellectual property law, grandfathering and the international laws, and really sort of forced the United States to kind of come into the modern time. Now, there's one other book I was going to show you. I got a tiny bit out of sequence here. It's just so exciting. It's hard to keep in mind everything all organized in that suitcase. Here's another one that I brought to kind of show the marriage of form and function in the late 1800s. Book binding and book publishing had kind of met that point where it could be done in a mass-produced manner, but they were still doing it old school, and the pictures were still really important. So I brought as an example of that, this is Don Quixote. This is one of, this is considered really the first really modern novel, and this edition here is from 1891, and it's a four-part series, but it's really cool inside. Hold on, I'll show you. Because what they did is they put all these pictures in. The pages are all hand-cut. Can you see from the side there? Right? So each page was lovingly hand-cut. This is as old a monk's style as I personally have come across. And I, considering the book's, well, quite old, I should probably be a little bit more gentle. Tyler, give me a hand. Hold up here. Look at the visual aids here that Tyler's going to show you. It has these little nice tissue papers covering these nice etchings within the thing, and it goes throughout the story, which all the text is all hand-laid. You can actually, there's tactility to it. You can hold, rub your hand against the print of it. Yeah. And it has texture, and it's got these beautiful illustrations in it. And this was kind of the marriage, the high point, what I think, is of the form and the function. You have this classic piece of literature presented in this beautiful volume that was, production made, but still with an artistic flair and a sense of purpose to the book, that the artifact was important, which I'm going to get to that a little bit more. The other thing that was important about Ulysses I was going to mention from a literary standpoint is this really opened up stream of consciousness as a writing style. Stream of consciousness, the first person narrative, seems pretty natural to us. Live blogging, what's that? Stream of consciousness, yes? Anyone think so? First person, using all the old classics, you notice that it's all written in the third person. It really wasn't until the Confessions of St. Augustine and Jean-Jacques Rousseau and some of these guys that they're really talking in the first person, like, this is me, not me being someone else, but this is me, damn it. This is me telling everything that's inside of me as myself rather than a character. James Joyce took this a step further, and he put himself in the character, but included everything about the day. Usually, we like to include the interesting bits of our lives in our anecdotes, don't we? The high points, the low points. He put in all those points in between. The ones that usually aren't very interesting, yeah, they're all in here. This book, you see this, that's one day in Dublin. So, the funny thing is one day takes you about 3 months to read, but. All right, so. Censorship. Censorship is over in America, and print is free unless those words. How am I doing for time?
Yeah,
how much time do I have?
Literally about 7 minutes.
What's that?
About 7 minutes.
About 7 minutes?
Could be 10.
How about 20?
What do you need to do?
Okay. But they're turned into a different kind of censorship, economic censorship. We heard about the McCarthy Times back there in the 50s in America, where it just became un-American to do things that were un-American. And if you were un-American, well, they were just going to be ostracized and not allowed to be American anymore, because they've been branded with the un-Americanness. And here's a little something that I came across. It's Vladimir Lenin's remarks about War and Peace, the book there by Leo Tolstoy. And this struck me when I first pulled it off the shelf. It's like, wow, that's remarkable that literature can be so powerful that it causes massive political figures who had a huge impact on the world to feel like they have to do a response to address the topics raised in, I mean, can you imagine, I suppose you could imagine Barack writing down a little essay about something, Stephen Harper, not so much, Stefan Dion, yeah, he'd write something down, but no one really understand what he was saying. But then the other thing, and War and Peace is a fantastic piece of literature that I always remember Condoleezza Rice, they'd always say in her little sound bites that, oh yeah, she's read War and Peace in original Russian. And I'm like, well, she clearly missed the point of it, so maybe she should go back and read it in English. But the remarkable thing about this book was where it was published. It was published in, remember what we used to call Beijing, Peking, China? They printed these little bootleg copies of, clandestine copies of Lenin's remarks in China, in English, just to ship there, just to get to America for propaganda purposes. And while, don't worry, I don't call me. But I think it's important that things like this are allowed to circulate freely and live in libraries. I really learned the importance of that. I did some time in Utah and in high school, and I went to the same high school for like a year and a half where the Osmonds had gone, right? And it was pretty weird because I grew up in Surrey, and that's what it was like, really different, right? And I knew there was something really important about literature when I, in 11th grade, we were like, okay, in English class, in honors English, you can name any book you want to read. So I brought in Catcher in the Rye, and it was like, oh my god, I had to get a note from my mom, to say that I could read Catcher in the Rye. I was like, wow, literature has the power to freak people out like this. Then when we had to do our little book report, the teacher went up beforehand and said, now, Dave's read a really controversial book. And then it turns out the teacher had no idea what it was about. And I said, it's this guy who runs away from school and he kind of sorts his shit out while he's staying in cheap hotels. And she didn't believe me, right? She thought I was like lying about the book. But anyway, continuing on from James Joyce, my next stop in the literary tradition of that I'm going to point out is Jack Kerouac's On the Road. Anyone read this one?
Yes.
Okay. This one's a kind of a neat addition, and I just picked this up. The story about Kerouac writing On the Road was that he wrote it in one big long scroll, right? He was high on Benzedrine the whole time, but that's, you know, he tells about that, he writes about it, and I'm right out to get Benzedrine, and I'm right back, and I'm here typing. But you don't really understand the majesty of his type of work until you see it all in one look. May I show you? Within this mighty tome, there's not a single paragraph break, there's not a single line break, and they transcribed it verbatim from his original scroll, and they have this awesome typist, and he's rock, the typewriter, but there's not one break in the action here. So I'll spare you from reading a paragraph, because like it would take like all day, right? This was a really critical period because all of a sudden literature and you know, there was this highbrow and high-mindedness about it. You know, it was Dickens and Chaucer, and there had been like this modernist movement with Joyce and Ezra Pound and D.H. Lawrence and all these writers. But really, this was took it and spun it all out of control, and it was all of a sudden, wow! Anyone who has a story can tell should be telling it. So I think this was a critical stop along and a huge inspiration on me. Now, I'm going to have to skip some of this stuff because of the time, but I'm going to give you a quick choice. One, I can give you a list of how to make awesome stuff, or I can show you awesome stuff I have made that has influenced my social media production thing. Preferences?
Sure.
Okay. So, there I was, Guam. I realized that where's my slide? Okay. The form that had been perfected, case in point, that lovely Don Quixote, that's an awesome form of a thing, right? Ship copyright, we kind of had a handle on that. Quality discourse, the Greeks, we've never really been able to improve on them as far as I'm concerned. And this internet stuff, ooh, this could solve that distribution puzzle. And it did sort-ish right there in the 90s, right? Sort-ish. You guys were there in the 90s using the internet. Just wasn't as neat as it is now. But the last thing I had was something to express. I had some of that. Let's explore some of those things. Here is the oldest thing in my social media artifact. This is from March 10th, 1979. This is the Pig Express. For those of you who don't recognize these kind of purple fuzzy letters, this was called a DaveO machine. And you put this liquid stuff that kind of smelled like paint thinner in this little container, and had this reel to go around. And I made my little newsletter. This one here, I'm talking about the Canucks, the prospect that they might build a 62,000-seat stadium. They had originally planned to do that in Serbia, an easy place. Imagine that, eh? More charm and traffic poles, I think, if it's in Serbia. The P&E coming up, but in this case, Jake Milford was getting ready to fly to Sweden and go recruit Swedish hockey players. Can you imagine? Swedish hockey players on our Canucks? But this is my first little thing. I had a subscriber base of 35, which is about what I have now. And all this, I had something to say, and I was able to produce the content. Still, the distribution was a drag, right? You know, I had to physically create the artifact and then spread it around. So after about 3-4 issues, yeah, it tailed off, because I really wanted to work in color. Here's a little something for the ambassador back there. As soon as I saw you up there, I was like, oh, have I got a surprise for you. In fourth grade or so, like I really like book reports were my favorite part, you know, I had to produce reports. But I look at this and it's like, damn, this is like, it's like a little web page. It's like a little slideshow presentation, except instead of HTML markup, I was using scissors and glue. So it's the same way I'd make a blog post now. If I had to do a little something about Norway, I'd put in some pictures, a little bit of text there. But alas, this, it's really hard to mass produce because like each one of them, like I had to cut up a magazine for the pictures, so this is it, right? Plus, I didn't think it was likely to get picked up by like, you know, National Geographic or something, so it's sort of like an end life of this project. Yet I had a desire to share these projects with more people. So, I realized that, the microphone. Did you miss the last part? Do you want me to recap the last part? It was really good. Okay, so then I started saying, writing a book report on Norway isn't really my life's calling, but punk rock is. And the 80s, to me, were a golden period of self-publishing and grassroots publishing because of the humble Xerox machine or the photocopier made by whatever brand that you have. And my parents were in real estate, and they have Xerox copiers there at the real estate offices. It turns out they're not free. These were lovingly produced at various real estate offices in Surrey. And that's the Ramones there. And in here, it's starting to see like, okay, there's a kind of closing the loop a little bit, you know? You can say, here, well, that's about it. I hope you enjoyed it. Please send any comments or complaints about this zine with an apostrophe. Once again, all contributions will be used. I'm easy. And you'll get a free zine as well. Yeah. But the reason I was doing this is because I realized that you can be an expert as long as you write something that says that kind of backs you up, right? And I realized that if you're an expert and a media outlet, then you can get free ship. So this is how I got free records. This ad right here, paid for, a box of records, done and done. And but it was still a little bit of a tricky distribution scheme because every once in a while someone would send some stamps and $2 and request a copy, and I'd have to put it in an envelope and put stamps on it. But it was a great way to start collecting and exchanging, and most of the zine readers were other zine writers. Does that sound familiar? That's why I love retweets so much. You know, someone puts out a message and then everyone else puts out the exact same message, so I got 12 copies of the same thing. All people reading the same thing. So, this also gave me an opportunity to collaborate and give a little shout out to Bev Davies, who I'll be talking to at Northern Voice. Bev Davies was a huge influence on my young life as a social media maker, although we didn't call it that, because she would go take pictures of the punk rock shows and she would let fanzines use them. Wow. So at Northern Voice, I'm going to ask her all the reasons about that. But for me, it was a really huge deal because you could start to see how people would exchange things, and then bands would take those and build up their reputations. And then you start going and you start making friends. You start meeting people through your fanzine. And before you know it, you build up a culture. Okay, while I was digging through, I'm going to show you that it wasn't just me doing all this crazy stuff. This here is the DOA and Friends coloring book. Anyone know the punk band DOA in Vancouver? All right. They made a coloring book. And I should be really gentle with that, but here, hold that up for me, John, and you can show a couple of the pages. Like, you can take it out and show a couple of pages. I just don't want to, like, mess it up. But isn't that cute? Like, a punk rock band would say, we'll make a little coloring book. We'll staple it together, and we'll call it a publication. So then I started traveling a little bit farther afield, And would always put my notebook in here. I went to Europe with a one-way ticket and $100 Canadian tucked in my shoe and a backpack. I ended up traipsing around for about 3 months picking grapes and stuff like that. But doing it, instead of taking a camera, because I didn't have one, and I thought, you know, cameras, sometimes you can hide behind the camera and it's like you'll enjoy shit later if you take a picture of it now. And I wanted a little bit more immediacy and kind of feel like, you know, going to Europe, it wasn't that big of a deal anymore. There was still borders, and it was before ATMs and different currencies. So it's a little bit of adventure, but I said, I'm going to go with no prior knowledge. I read a 1972 guidebook to hitchhiking through Europe, just so I could, you know, not really have any real context. And I took a notebook and some paints. And so I made some little sketches along the way. There's the guy that picked me up and started smoking heroin off some aluminum foil and drove me to Germany. Looked just like that, too. Oh, there's the guy smoking the huge joints at the Turkish music festival. Some people picked me up and took me too, and then I did quite a bit of writing on that too. And when I finally came across this notebook again, not too long ago, I said, "Well, what do I do with this stuff?" Guess what? Start a WordPress blog. I start transcribing all that stuff in there, and then I was digging through here, and I was going to tell you the importance. And this was the tip that was going to go in the list about how to make cool stuff, which is always have a notebook with you. And notebooks are really handy for writing poetry, but also when you're hitchhiking, you can make your hitchhiking signs. And I thought I would take this as a, when I went to Europe as, you know, Canadian, so people didn't mix me up as an American using some other hitchhiking school notebook. But these are kind of neat. These are kind of cool mementos of the trip, you know, my little hitchhiking signs. But this kind of stuff, it's part of your personal story and your personal stuff, and it goes in that pile of having something to talk about. And all of you have done some kind of trip or some kind of adventure that kind of took you over. Oh, this one's good. Taking you out of your comfort zone. And that's the kind of stuff you should write about. Oh, good times. You'll probably notice that there's not too many signs after hauling. Once you get the answer. It's really hard to leave. I made some paintings there in Europe. You can look at them later. Then I discovered computers, and I thought, oh, I could take all these short stories and poetry I've been writing on all my trips, and I could put them on this thing. But the problem is, it's these really computers with this dot matrix print is fucking ugly. I don't want this. I don't want to distribute this. I want a beautiful book. Right? I want some thing that you can hold on and go, ooh, it's lovely. Look at these lovely images and feeling. Instead, it's like this. It looks like some tax form or something like that. This wasn't a very fun way to distribute my work. So it wasn't long after that I decided, I learned about those color copiers that just come out like, you know, years ago. And I got a job at Kinko's. I'll let you think about that for a second. And I did 3 months hard time at Kinko's just so I could use their color copier after hours, because I thought I could make a nicer looking little book. So I decided to take the influence of European post-impressionist painting and Japanese haiku and sort of mash them together. Apparently there's not a big demand for this, but I thought it was really here. And I made I made some wee little chapbooks, as they call them. And it's had, look at that, color cover. Pretty nice, eh? And then I went black and white inside, you know, both for aesthetic and financial purposes. And you know, because I'm really into, I kind of just jammed these in, it's not sewn together. The ones I sent around, you know, I got some nice thread, I sewed them up and hand-bound them. But holy shit, that was quite a project, right? You know, I maybe made like 50 copies of them. And I, you know, I'm not stupid. I know 40 of the people that I sent them to, they're like, great, Dave's got some stuff. So, undaunted, I carry on with my projects. But in these projects, I've tried to figure out how to take this analog workmanship and this analog creative process and make that and couple it with the internet. And so I did all these internet businesses in the 90s, and I started with Notepad and Angly Bracket, HTML Clothes, Angly Bracket, and all this kind of stuff. But it's still a drag because you have all these websites. And my first web page I made was about the history of hemp in Japan, and I learned how to make a web page, but I didn't know how to make web pages where they connected them together. So like my first web page, it was like a Zen cone. How long can a web page be, you know? Until you hit save, until you, it could be as long as you want. And you could be continually making a page. Turns out that's not the best way to make a page. But then lo and behold, the final little piece of the puzzle, the findability came about with RSS. So I met Dave Weiner at Nomex a couple years ago, and Dave Weiner, he's like curmudgeonly old professor, you know, computer geek that invented RSS. I'm like, wow, hey, Dave Weiner, nice to meet you. My name's Dave. Thanks for inventing RSS. You know, most guys named Dave are pretty friendly, so that's a little like, wow. Yeah, it's true, isn't it? Most guys named Dave. You know many assholes named Dave? And I said, Dave, can I take your picture? Put it on the Flickr.
I wish digital cameras had never been invented.
Oh, what a sweetheart. Well, thanks anyway for making the fucking RSS, dude. And a lot of people have different objectives and different reasons why they even care that this stuff exists. Some people see it purely for financial purposes and a means to an end to make some money. Some people see it as a better way to promote and market, and I know that. I do a marketing gig for as a day job. You know, I make a paycheck. Come see this awesome building content, right? I know how it works. But there's really something to be said for looking beyond this immediate short-term future, and even beyond looking in terms of it as a blog, and saying that all these puzzles of the publishing tension, the conundrums, have been solved. We now have a distribution tool that can indeed publish for free or cheap, anywhere, anyhow, and the steps now to take that and use that as a collaborative tool to build something that can then come full circle and turn into an analog artifact that people can enjoy sitting by the fire, but you're building something online, and then the content and the delivery method have really been completely separated where they can be any way that you want. The trick is thinking of something that you have to, that you have the ability to share that not everyone else does. Now, some people say that not everyone has an artistic spark, not everyone's a Van Gogh, no one thought Van Gogh was either, right? You know, not everyone's Henry David Thoreau. No one thought Henry David Thoreau was anything when Henry David Thoreau was writing. He died penniless at 37, then, 100 years later, changed the world. Civil disobedience, nonviolence. So it's, I think there's something to be said for looking beyond the immediate benefits and really look and say, we have this opportunity with these tools. We have the ability to communicate at a high level. There's kind of rules and structure around editing and writing of what makes things good that you can learn about. So it's up to you, is that bottom one. If you can't read it, it says something to express. Then I'm going to go to the next one. That's my chart. I think it's called a Venn diagram, but I don't know much about those. It used to be the end goal of making something was to find a publisher, find a record deal, get that contract. The big executive comes and tells you, your work is worthy. I'm going to sign you to a contract. We don't need them anymore. The gatekeepers have fallen. We can create and interact, or are falling anyway. We can create and interact with our own community, and we can build a culture around our way of thinking. Whatever you're into, you can build things around that, and you can interact. And then you can end up right here in this awesome middle space. Is this a Venn diagram? Anyone know about charts?
Almost. Chart? Yeah. Another one. Usually there's three circles.
Hold on. We can add one. I got a Sharpie.
Sure, you can have a Venn diagram. No, because it's inside the box, right? So. Scratch.
Yeah. She's wrong. Right. She's wrong anyway. It is a Venn diagram.
Okay. Well, I always kept, ever since Rockstar Bootcamp, they told me to keep a Sharpie with me all the time, just in case I have to modify my Venn diagrams. This particular Venn diagram, there's circle one that says awesomeness. Actually awesome because I ran out of space. I should draw in the circle bigger. I also, for those of you who are really into, like charts always seem to have some like little variable symbols, so I put an X on it. Doesn't actually mean anything. Actually the X stands for color one. This circle should be a different color than this circle, which is color Y. And it represents audience, right? So you can be making awesome stuff and not have an audience, and you can be have an audience and not be making awesome stuff. Your goal is to end up here in the middle, designated here with the kind of modified diagonal hash marks. In this area of the hash marks is where you want to hang. This is the area where your awesomeness and your audience comes together, and you have breathed life into a project because you have put your soul into something. You put the log back in the blog. The blog is to talk about this awesomeness that you're doing here. Perhaps you're making this a series of discourse about some topic that's incredibly compelling to you. Perhaps you're engaging, like many of you do, with various charitable organizations, and not just helping for a one time, but helping change the culture and helping educate other people about how to do the same thing. We can think of projects in a longer term that might stretch over 5 years and separate them from the delivery method. You can really let yourself engage in some bigger things. Now, before I totally start segueing into party time, because anyone who knows me knows I don't want to interrupt any beer drinking time, I'm going to show you just two more last things that kind of show me trying to close the loop on some of these big projects. I've kind of talked about these large story arcs. So I have all this poetry that I've been collecting. Anyone else like write a little poetry and have notebooks in your drawer and you're like, oh, one of these days I'm totally going to do some of these? Okay, so here's what I did. I started taking all the notebooks, and whenever I wasn't feeling particularly inspired to write per se, I would put a little LP on the record player, smoke a little reefer, crack open a few beers, and I'd start transcribing. And in doing the transcribing from original journals, I shut down my self-editing voice. This is an imperative step, because as soon as you start reading your stuff that was awesome when you wrote it, you'll go, oh my god, douchebaggery, who said this? And I know this because I totally do it, right? And for my little podcast, if I listen back to them, I'm like, whoa, self-important douchebag. With it. So put on your editing toque. I'm wearing my editing toque here. And transcribe this. My easiest way to do it was just to plop it into a WordPress.com blog, because I'm not very codey or crafty on that kind of stuff. So I have a writer's notebook blog. It's public and people can see it, although I don't think people really do. But I look at it more as a workbook, and where I can start to transcribe and assemble all these things. Then this summer, what I went through, I started breaking them up. How can I turn these into collections, right? How can I like put some sort of thematic thread? Are they, should I arrange them chronologically? Should I arrange them by theme? What should I do? So one day I got this printer that I was a tester of, right? I was a print tester log program or something. I wrote a review about it or something. But it was really handy because I printed out the whole blog. Isn't that funny? One of those people that printed a blog. I went down to Ambleside Beach and I started dividing out all the poetry into four piles. And I started to notice some common threads. I go, ooh, alright, I got something coming together here. And they span years and locations, but there's sort of some common themes throughout them. So I started to assemble them and I said, oh great, now I got four piles of shit that I'm not going to do anything with. So then I futzed around and thought about it for a little bit and I said, you know what, I should just make it into a little something that people can, because I didn't want to print out a bunch of things and sew them together because like I got other shit to do on my weekends, right? So I said, I'll make your own book. I will take the poetry from the blog, put it in a document, make it into a PDF, and then publish it as a PDF, and then let people print it out and chop it up into whatever they want. So I have one draft copy of it. Now, one mistake I made is I didn't put little crop marks on it, but that's cool because it can be more like that Don Quixote. All the pages are all kind of like messed up and different sizes, a little bit more artsy craftsy. And you get to do it on whatever paper you want because it's your dot, it's your printer. So in closing, I would like to offer you in a manner of breathing life into my own projects and encouraging a culture around this stuff that I hope will last.